So if you have those blankets, please bring them to the church. We'll be here tomorrow at 7:30 for our prayer. Bring them by the church, and we'll make sure that we get those to those people who are in need on this Saturday coming. Amen. And just to you guys who haven't been a part of the homeless feeding, amen. If you have open Saturday, come on out and be a part of that. We have an awesome time, get an opportunity to fellowship and communicate the gospel and to just love on some people that are in need of love. And so that's what the homeless feeding is all about. So if you find yourself free one Saturday morning, 9:30, meet us over on Blunt Road, and be a part of that morning service. It only takes about 30, 40 minutes. By 10 o'clock, 10:15, we're done. It's a good way to start your Saturday mornings. But remember, I'm looking for blankets. So if you have some blankets that you're not using, please bring those to the church so that we can get those to the people. Because the weather is changing and a lot of people are in need of blankets. We have
also socks. They ask for socks quite often.
Amen. Socks also. Socks also. If you have some socks that you're able to donate, please bring those out. And we'll get them over to the people if you're not able to make it on Saturday morning. I want to acknowledge, we have a visitor today. I can't read their first name, but the last name is Anderson, I believe. They're a guest of Mr. Carl. Amen. What's your first name, brother?
Terrell.
Terrell, amen. Put your hands together for Terrell. Amen. Today, God bless the Senators for inviting them, giving him the opportunity to come and to be with us today in service. Amen. We encourage our members to invite their family, their loved ones to come out and be a part of the services. So we thank God for them sharing the gospel with them and providing this opportunity to come and fellowship with us. If you have your Bibles, let's go to 2 Peter, the first chapter. If you need a Bible, if you just raise your hand, we'll get one to you. Amen. We got a few people in the corner over there. We want to make sure everybody has their sword. Amen. Amen. All of the members of this ministry should have their own Bible. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. What is a soldier that has no weapon?
Amen.
And you're going to get in trouble. You're a soldier, you need to make sure you have your weapon, and you need to know how to use your weapon. I ain't never been in the service, but if I'm not mistaken, they have to teach you how to break it down and put it back together. You have to be pretty familiar with that weapon, because on the battlefield, not only does your life, but the man standing next to you, his life depends on your ability to properly use your weapon. So if you don't have a Bible, amen, go and buy your Bible. Amen. So that you can take notes and write in it and mark different scriptures and things of that nature. So that you'll be able to be a skilled warrior. A skilled warrior. Everybody should have a Bible. Go get you a good study Bible. Amen. Once again, I want to go to the book of 2 Peter, the first chapter. Today I want to talk about the Bible itself. And I want to talk about your attitude towards the Bible. What should my attitude be towards the Bible? First of all, I want to do, what is it? What is the Bible? Then I want to deal with what our attitude should be concerning the Bible. Amen. I'm going to do a lot of reading, but I want you to walk away today with a good understanding of what your Bible is to you. That's the reason why I gave the illustration of a soldier. Your Bible is to you just like that soldier's weapon is to him. It's very important. You're going to be successful in this life, in this warfare that we're living. It's very important that you know how to use your Bible. Amen. Once again, we're going to 2 Peter, the first chapter. I'm going to start in verse number 12, and I'm going to read down talk a little bit this morning. The Bible says, verse number 12, wherefore I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though ye know them and be established in the present truth. Yea, I think it meet, as long as I am in this tabernacle, to stir you up by putting you in remembrance, knowing that shortly I must put off this tabernacle, even as our Lord Jesus Christ has showed me. So Peter, talking to those who were under him, those who he was responsible for leading, he says, I'm going to continue to remind you of the things that I've told you concerning the word of God. That's what he's talking about. He's talking about the ministry to them of the word of God. He says, I'm going to continue to remind you of the word that I've already given you. I'm going to take every opportunity that I have to continue to remind you of what I've already told you. He says, God has already revealed to me that my time on earth is coming to an end. When Peter talks about the tabernacle, he's talking about his own physical body. When he talks about his tabernacle, he's talking about his physical body. He's saying that God has revealed to me that I'm getting ready to die. Verse number 12. Verse number 13. Yea, I think it meet, as long as I am in this tabernacle, talking about his body, as long as I'm in this physical body, to stir you by the putting you in remembrance, to keep reminding you of what I've already told you. He says, verse number 14, knowing that shortly I must put off this tabernacle, even as the Lord Jesus Christ has showed me. God has revealed to me that my time on earth is coming to an end, and that I'm going to have to take off this tabernacle, that body. We talked about this before, that we are much more than this physical body. This physical body is just a vehicle that we use while we're here in the earth, and that this physical body will one day return to the dust. But the real quarry is going on into eternity. And I have a tabernacle, if you will, that has not been made with man's hand, but has been made by God waiting for me. And so Peter is saying the same thing here. He say, I gotta go. God, he's shown me that my time is up here, and that I gotta move on to eternity. But while I'm here, I'm going to continue to remind you of the things that I've already told you, because they're that important. He says, moreover, I will endeavor that you may be able, after my decease, to have these things always in remembrance. I'm trying to prepare you for my departure. For we have not followed cunning devised favors. When we made known unto you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the holy mountain. So Peter says that the stuff I've been telling you is not cunningly devised fables. This is not something we made up, but this is something that we have witnessed with our own eyes. We have walked with Christ. We have talked with Christ. We have heard him. We have eaten with him. We have been there with him. We were on the mount when God manifested himself to him and said that this is my beloved Son in whom I well pleased. So Peter says, everything that I have received, I am giving it to you. All of the wealth of knowledge and wisdom and revelation that God receive. He says, I'm giving that to you so that when we are gone, you will be able to carry on.
Amen.
So that when I lay off this tabernacle, you won't be stuck. You won't be in trouble. You won't be in a bad position. And that's the reason why I'm trying to give you all that I have to give you, so that when I'm gone, you will be able to carry on. He says, because you got to, one of the things we have to understand about life is that a lot of times trouble is going to come. And so what God does is he prepares us beforehand for what's going to come. Anytime a teacher gives the test, she gives the test based on information she's already presented. And the purpose of the test is to see whether or not you have retained the information that she has already presented to you. A lot of times when God deals with us, he deals with us in a way where he gives us a test, but before he allows us to go through the test, he first gives us what's necessary to make it through the test. Bible says, I won't put on you more than you're able to better, able to handle, able to bear, but with every trial and temptation, he says, with the temptation, I will give you a way of escape or a way to bear the temptation. In other words, God said, before you go through it, I'm going to prepare you for it. Before the storm comes to your house, I'm going to make sure you're equipped to deal with the storm so that you will only have to do or utilize what I've already given you. And so Peter, in the same way, is reminding the Christians before he died. He says, I've given you what you need. I've given you what you need. When I leave you, you're going to go through some stuff. You're going to face some storms. But understand, I've given you what you need to survive. I've given you what you need to be a strong child of God. I've given you what you need to be to build a strong marriage. I've given you what you need to have a success in your finances, to have success in your body, to have success in your job. He says, everything that you need, I've given it to you. I've prepared you. I'm just reminding you of the stuff that I've already given you, because when I leave here, you're going to have to call all of this stuff back to remembrance to survive the storms that's coming your way.
Yes.
He says, for we receive from God the Father honor and glory. For he, excuse me, received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the holy mountain. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto we do well that we take heed as unto the light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your heart. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of scripture is of any private interpretation. I want you to focus on verse number 19. Because after Peter goes through the litany, after he begins to tell them that what I have, I received firsthand from God himself, or what I have, I received firsthand from Christ himself. I walked with him, I talked with him, I heard him personally teaching me and instructing me the things of God. But then in verse number 19, he said, but we have a more sure word of prophecy. He said, God has given us a more sure word of prophecy that we may rely and trust and have confidence in the more sure word of prophecy. What is that word he's talking about? He said, there is something that God has given us that's just as good as my personal walking and experience that I had with God, with Christ.
Yes.
It's very important. He said, God has given us something that is more sure, that is just as good as what I had when I personally walked the earth with Christ. He says, it is a sure word of prophecy. Verse number 19, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto we do well to take heed unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your heart. The word of prophecy that he's speaking of is the word of God. He's talking about what you hold in your hand. He's saying what you hold in your hand is just as good as what I had when I walked with Christ himself. You have a more sure, a more excellent word of prophecy that you can count on, that you can rely on, that you can put your confidence in. What, remember what we started talking about?
Amen.
When I determine what it is, it's going to determine how I value it, how I treat it, how I treat the information that it provides. So if I'm going to really value the Bible, if I'm going to really value this sure word of prophecy, I have to have a good understanding of what it is. Because it's having a good understanding of what it is that's going to determine whether or not I value it. Everybody value. We value things differently. We don't all value the same thing. Some of us value one thing, some of us value something else. But the value you place on something depends on what it is to you. That's how we value it. You ever go to an art gallery and you see all the art on the wall? There are some people who pay thousands of dollars for paintings. Thousands of dollars. There are some people who go to the gallery and they're blown away by what they see. Then you got somebody else who goes to the gallery and it's nothing to them. They don't see what all the noise is about. They don't see what all the hype is about. Why? Because we value different things. We appreciate different things. But this is what's true. Whatever you value, whatever you appreciate, what is important to you, those are the things that you value. That's where your heart will be. And so anytime something is important to you, you value that. This is why I want to talk about the Bible today, because I want you to determine within yourself what value, what importance does the Bible have to you? What value, what importance does the Word of God have to you? Because how you value the Word of God is going to determine how you handle what I tell you. What the value that you place on the Word of God is going to determine how you value, or excuse me, it's going to determine how you treat the Word of God or the counsel of God, how you treat the wisdom of God's Word, how you order your life, or whether or not you order your life by the Word of God. What is the value that you place on the Word?
Yes.
The Bible talks about the man who goes out and sows the seed in the field. And it says the kingdom of the heaven is likened unto a man who goes and sows seed. And the Bible says that seed is the Word of God. That seed is the Word of God. The Bible says that some of the ground that he sows the seed on is hard ground. It's rocky ground. It's rocky ground. And because the ground is rocky ground, the seed is not able to bear fruit. Now, it's very important that you understand that the quantity of the seed was good. There was nothing wrong with the quality of the seed. The reason why the seed did not bear any fruit was because of the quality of the ground. The seed was not the problem. The ground was the problem. When the Bible talks about the ground, it's in reference to our heart. It's in reference to our spirit. Whether or not the Word of God is going to bear fruit in your life depends on the condition or the quality of your ground. Your heart is the ground. So no matter how hard somebody preaches to you, or no matter how hard the Word of God comes across your table, if your heart is not prepared to receive the seed, then the seed is not going to bear any fruit in your life.
Amen.
No matter how the Word is presented to you, if you don't value the Word, I don't care how good the wisdom is,
yes, yes.
The mother or the father can have all the wisdom in the world, but if that child does not listen or does not value the words of their mother and rolls their eyes when the mother or dad is talking, they do not value the counsel of wisdom, then that wisdom is worth nothing to them. I got to get you to understand this. See, wisdom is only valuable to you when you value the wisdom. Wisdom can only benefit you when you value what you're receiving. No matter how much wisdom somebody try to give you, if it's not valued, if you don't see the value in it, then it cannot help you. Give you another example. You go to the doctor tell you you need to